there's no more truth than what's been spoken already. We've already had church. And I do believe that when we have such weeks where there's been downtrodden, where we've had affliction, where we've had all these issues, and you come into the house of the Lord, man, if we just sing two songs and let the preacher preach and walk out the door, sometimes we don't get what we need. Sometimes the most encouraging part is hearing other people's victory stories and hearing other people, man, I'm not the only one struggling. I'm not the only one that's battling. And you start to hear how God delivered them and God delivered this one and God delivered that one. You're like, yep, you know what? God is faithful. He is true. He is just. He is the King. And he does love me when I'm not lovable. And may I get excited about those things. I love it. I love coming into a church where there's no agenda. There's no somebody that has priority over another. There's one priority in this church, and it's very evident. It's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And his name is lifted above all names. And that's what we've come to do today. We've come to worship God. We came to celebrate what he does in our lives. And through that, we can look through his scripture. We're going to look at some things today that God has just beaten me to pieces with. I was driving up the road going to go watch my son. He's playing college baseball, and they're playing up at D&E yesterday and today. And as I was driving, man, I had the radio off, and I was just preaching, and I was singing, and I was, and Tim was interrupting me, and he was texting me, and I wait a minute, I just admit I was texting and driving.
Yeah.
I was doing it verbally.
Yeah.
And next thing you know, I'm almost to Bridgeport.
Yeah.
You ever been to Elkins?
Yeah.
You don't go to Bridgeport.
No.
You can't get there from there.
Yeah, okay.
So I started looking for a U-turn in the middle of the highway, and I found one and switched it over, and through there I went. Don't worry, I was in a rental car, so if they see me, it was an Illinois license plate.
Yeah.
And I just said, you know, when the power of the Lord gets a hold of you, you lose sense of time.
Amen.
You lose sense of direction. You lose sense of everything because you're in his presence. And I love that song, day and night, night and day. Let my incense arise. That's my prayer. That's my glory. That's my praise and my testimony. And man, I just to get excited about what God is doing. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, I do thank you for this day. God, I feel your presence in this house, Lord. This is your house. Lord, we have come into your home today, Lord. Lord, we've come into the place that we call holy. Lord, we've come into the place to offer up our sacrifices of praise, God. Lord, I pray that you would be with us as we open up your word, God. Lord, I am an unworthy vessel filled with a worthy message today. Lord, I pray that it flows out of this body, the Lord, the way that you have filled it to come out. Lord, I'm not even sure what you're going to pour out today, but I know it's going to be good because it's of you. Lord, be with our hearts. Lord, be with our minds. Lord, let us be receptive unto the word, God. Lord, let it cut asunder, Lord. Let it cut to the soul of the man, God. Lord, let it be applicable. Let us walk out of here changed and challenged. Lord, for you are worthy of it all. And we praise you for it. In your holy and precious name, I do pray. Amen.
Amen.
As I started with this message, I started with a question. And it's a question that I'm going to ask you that I want you to ponder more than today. I want you to ponder this question through the message, but I want you to ponder this question for your life. And as I was going through messages and I was praying to God and the Lord was talking to me, he said this to myself, and man, he beat me up over this for the last few weeks. And I thought, if he's going to kick my rear end over it, I'm going to let him kick your rear end over it. Is your vision stronger than your memory?
Yeah.
And I mean, just smack me.
Yeah.
We all have a vision of doing something great. God, I want to be a better Christian. God, I want to be a stronger witness for you. God, I want to preach the word. God, I want to sing the word. God, I want to lead souls to Christ. God, I'm all in. And when we are in the house of the Lord, man, isn't that an easy thing to say?
Yeah.
We get up and we sing the song, I surrender all. All to Jesus, I surrender. Man, that's easy to sing, but that is so hard to live. Why? Because when you walk out, your memories become stronger than your vision.
True.
And man, he said, Ben, is your vision any stronger than what your memories are? Man, Satan is so good about bringing those memories right back up into my mind.
Yeah, yeah.
When you start to declare, hey, God, I'm gonna do this for you today. God, I'm gonna do that for you today. God, I'm gonna be this kind of a husband, and I'm gonna be this kind of a dad. I'm going to be this kind of a leader and a worker. And Satan goes, well, you haven't before.
Yeah, right.
Because remember, and all of a sudden we start agreeing with the wrong party.
Yeah, you're right.
And we start agreeing with the voices that come into our heads that's not of God. And it's so easy to get into that. And we got to realize our battle has nothing to do with the flesh.
No, no.
Our battle, and I have heard, listen, I'm going to tell you right now, the testimonies that I've heard today are going to go with this message to the T. I started almost laughing out loud back there. I thought, oh my goodness, Lord, I didn't know where this would go, but apparently you really did.
Yeah.
Because we don't battle against flesh and blood.
Right.
It is straight wickedness. Yeah. It is straight spiritual. Yep. It is straight the Satan himself. Amen. And we got to start calling it for what it is. Jesus was teaching. And Jesus was sitting with his disciples, and he was telling his disciples, hey, the time is coming. The time is going to come when I'm going to start to battle against these Pharisees and these Sadducees, and I'm going to tick them off so bad that they're going to kill me. They're going to come after my life. They're coming after my head. They're going to crucify me. Peter, not on my watch.
Yeah.
How did Peter start the battle right there?
Carnal, buddy.
Carnal. Jesus is talking about spiritual warfare, and Peter couldn't get outside of his own fleshly warfare. And how often do we sit in church and we hear this spiritual message, but we can't get past our fleshly battle?
Amen.
Peter's like, I know how to take care of those Sadducees, those Pharisees. I mean, he proved it in the garden, pulled out a sword, whacked their ear off. I mean, Peter was all about the flesh.
Yes.
Open your Bibles to Matthew. Matthew chapter 16. Folks, we got to start calling this for what it is. We got to start calling it for what it is. Matthew chapter 16, I paraphrase verse 21. Look at verse 22. Now, listen, Peter knew who Jesus was at the time that he said this. Could you imagine rebuking the Son of God?
Yeah.
Son, you're wrong.
Yeah.
I mean, I can just see Jesus be like, what? Listen to what it says. It says, then Peter took him. Could you imagine him going, hey, Jesus, I got to interrupt you for a minute. You need to come here. It says, Peter took the Son of the living God and rebuked him. Now, I've been taken before, and I've been rebuked before. I could not, in my wildest imaginations, take the living Son of God and say, I just need a moment of your time to tell you how wrong you are and how this is really going to play out. It says he took him, and he began to rebuke him and said, be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be done unto you, as if Peter had any authority. I just, hey, Jesus, let me just tell you how it is. That ain't going to happen on my watch. Hey, folks, can you please stop battling in the flesh? Can you please stop trying to defeat Satan, a formidable foe, in the flesh? He will wipe the mat with you.
Yes, he will. That's right.
He will put you up against the rope so fast. He will have your soul, and he will sift you like wheat.
Yeah, that's a fact.
You can't fight spirit by flesh.
Amen.
Can't happen. Look what Jesus said. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. Can we call it for what it is?
Yeah.
He didn't say, Peter, you're wrong. He didn't say, Peter, you're misunderstood. He didn't say, Peter, I value your opinion. He said, Satan, shut up.
Amen.
We got to start calling it for what it is.
Amen.
Spiritual warfare is what it is. It wasn't Peter speaking. That was Satan speaking through Peter. He said, Satan, get behind me, for thou art an offense unto me. Could you imagine if we started calling things for what they are in this world? Could you imagine if you walked up to someone when they started their talking and their jabbering and you said, hey, Satan, how well is that going to go over?
Yeah.
Hey, Satan, right now, I need you at this moment just to get behind me because right now you're the offense to me. Jesus did this for a reason.
Yeah.
He did it for a reason, to show us that when people come against us, it's not the person coming against us. It's the spirit of Satan that is coming against us. And it's not going to stop until the day that Jesus Christ himself stomps his head. It's going to continue. Call it for what it is. Satan, get behind me. You're an offense unto me. You're trying to slow me down for what I'm doing. Look at this. For thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that are of men. You know what that was? That was the stink line was saying, you know what? You don't savor the things that are spiritual. You savor things that are fleshly. Are your memories stronger than your vision? Are you letting the fleshly memories keep you from your spiritual vision? Man, I feel like the Lord's calling me to preach. I feel like the Lord's calling me to teach. I feel like the Lord is calling me to be a missionary. I feel like the Lord is calling me to, you know, go witness to my neighbor. But that spiritual calling is quenched by a fleshly memory. Guys, it's a battle. It's never going to stop. What did Jesus come right back with? Look what he says. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself. Now, I stopped right there and I began to read this, because that word deny, got me. And I started thinking this week, okay, well, what does that word really encompass? Is it that I'm supposed to deny things that I like? I enjoy sports, so if I'm going to be called of God, I got to deny those sports? No. That's not what that word deny means. Well, I enjoy music, so I've got to shove music away, and it's got to be all, you know, at the altar all day long. No, no. I enjoy hunting, or I enjoy fishing, so I can't do that. I got to deny what I like. You think God, the Almighty God, created an earth for you not to enjoy it?
Right.
That word deny means to refuse self claims against yourself. Self claims. What is a self claim? You're not good enough.
Right.
You're not smart enough. You're not fast enough. You're not worthy enough. You're not perfect enough. You're not eloquent in speech enough. You're not educated enough. Yeah. You're not. Those are self-claims that will be memorized in your memory, that will completely and utterly make you abandon your spiritual calling.
Absolutely.
He said, if you're going to do this, if a man wants to follow me, he's got to deny himself. He's got to get rid of this fleshly memory of who he thinks he is, and do what? Pick up his cross.
Yeah.
Now, when I was taken years ago, I was taking my concealed weapons permit. And I remember the very first thing that God told us. We were in the house and we were going over things. He said, I'm going to tell you this right now. Never draw your weapon unless you're willing to take someone's life. Number one thing. You don't pull that gun unless you're willing to use it. When you pick up that cross, it's a declaration of warfare.
Yes, it is. Amen.
Don't you pick that cross up unless you're willing to fight. Because I will tell you this, the moment that you pick that cross up, the moment that you raise that banner and you declare God, the battle is on.
Yes.
And if you're not willing to fight, leave your cross where it is and go ahead and live in your memory.
Come on, buddy.
When that cross is raised, it is a signal that I'm ready to fight. Now, I want to look what happens. I brought some things today. I wanted to use this as a very good illustration. This is a coach's favorite seat in baseball. It's also a bucket to hold baseball. So, I want Mr. Dave, come on up. I didn't know this guy was a catcher and a baseball guy. We had a good conversation. I said, Lord, no wonder that you have me use this today. So we got a bunch of baseballs here. So I want you to look at these baseballs today as life. These are just things in life. So this is work. You know, these are, you know, relationships. And look, you know, he's a baseball guy. So as soon as he got the baseball in his hand, that's what he started to do.
Yeah.
You know, he's got work. He's got life. He's got bills. He's got a house. You know, he's got all kinds of things. He's got, you know, apparently wild dogs. He's got a wedding coming up, and he's got a wife and kids. I'm sure you got some bills to pay. What else you got going on in your life? You got car payments, probably. Maybe some house payments. You can get your glasses so we don't break this.
This is going to get interesting.
You know, you got church to attend, people to make happy. Don't you drop those.
Quick.
You got what? Got grass to mow, probably, snow to shovel in the wintertime. You got all these things going on, and Satan just packs these in here. You got to read your Bible.
Right,
you got to make people happy.
Right,
you got to attend church when you don't feel good. You got to sing songs.
This is what he does, buddy. Right.
And he loads your hands up, and then he says, hey, you know what I need you to do? Yeah. We're going to pretend this is your cross. Hey, I need you to go pick up your cross.
Hands are full, buddy.
I need you. Now, hold on a minute. I just need you to pick up that cross. Now, here's what good church people do. Here's what good church people do. I can't believe that you're not picking up your cross.
Yeah, right.
How can you not follow God and pick up your cross? He said to pick up your cross.
Yeah,
and you're just standing there doing nothing. Well, wait a minute, doing nothing. I'm holding my life together.
Yeah.
I've got my life all in my hands. Pick up your cross, brother. A good Christian would pick up his cross. And then all of a sudden, here comes what the Bible says to do. Let me help you with this.
Yeah.
You don't need to make people happy.
Yeah.
Let me help you mow your grass.
I don't want that.
Let me read the Bible with you. Let me help you with these things.
Sure.
And all of a sudden, all of these things start being picked up because a brother and sister in Christ is to share your burdens and share your load and take away all the things that are holding you down. Because none of these things matter. Now, brother, just pick up your cross.
Right on, buddy.
You can't pick up your cross when your hands are full. And he puts the memories and he loads you down like a wagon.
Yeah.
And then we wonder, why is my brother not picking up his cross? Because you ain't helping him.
Glasses.
Oh, yeah.
There's glasses.
Jesus said, Peter, pick up your cross. Did you notice that Jesus didn't give him a list of rules and regulations? Because Jesus knew in order for the cross to be picked up, he had to get rid of things.
Yeah.
It's like taking a glass of water and putting a couple bits of dirt in there. And then I tell you, pick the dirt out. How about this? We just tip the jar a little bit and flood the good water in. Where's that dirt going to go? It'll flush out.
Yeah.
I don't need to tell you all your sins. I don't need to come and say, hey, remove this, remove that, remove this, do this and do that. And here's 12 rules and 13 rules and get holy. And I just need to tell you, pick up your cross.
Amen.
Love Jesus. Amen. Fill yourself with the word. Fill yourself. And next thing you know, I got to let go of some of these things because I'm having a new desire. Because my vision is stronger than my memory. Because I'm not living in the flesh. Now, as we just went through this, I want you to have that picture in your mind. Verse 25. For whosoever will save his life will lose it. Well, what if our brother would have said, you know what? This is my life. I got to keep it. He would have lost the cross.
Right. Yes, he would have.
As I was driving down the road yesterday, God's like, this is the example I want you to use because so many people don't understand this. If I gain my life, I'm going to actually lose it. Well, what's that mean? If we retain the life,
absolutely,
we actually lose the cross.
Yes. Yeah. Amen.
Look what the next verse says. As we keep reading, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake, find it.
Yes.
There's more.
Yeah.
As we started helping our brother unravel, guess what we started to do? We started to free up the ability to grab more Jesus. The one that will lose his life will actually gain life. For what will it profit a man if he would gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in glory in his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily, I say unto you, there will be some of you here that shall not taste of death till you see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. I began to think about this picking up our cross. It is a battle. Church, if you don't think you're in a battle, you ain't picked up your cross.
Okay.
I'm going to tell you right now, if you say, amen, my life is pretty good, things are going well, raise your cross higher.
Yeah.
Put the target out there. Peter, Satan, get behind me. You're an offense to me right now. You're slowing me down. Because if a man's going to follow me, he's got to pick up that cross. He's got to be willing to take some battles and some hits. He's got to be willing to take some blows and some black eyes and some arrows in the back. He's got to be willing to take that. It's coming. Trust me. It's just the prelude. It's the prelude. It's coming.
Amen.
Peter was so caught up in the flesh that he missed spirit. A lot of times. But he got it. He's a slow learner. You know, I've raised rabbit dogs a lot and hunted all over the U.S. with our dogs. And you know, you had a lot of times in a litter, you had this really fast pup. That man, you introduce it to something, and bang, it's chasing a rabbit. And all of a sudden, I had this little fat little male pup that sat there, like, what's that in here doing? It ain't even feed time yet. And it would, you turn it loose in the pen and when you're first training them, and he'd go over and want to eat the food, and you got these little guys going. Well, all of a sudden, one day, it just clicked. That's us so many times.
Yep.
There are a lot of people that sit in church and they hear the word of God, and they hear the word of God, and they hear the word of God, and they hear the word of God. And we think, well, that pup's no good. Look at these ones over here running really well. This one's no good. It's man, we just thought that's a call. It's just a call pup. No good. I guess I'll just give it away. And all of a sudden, a year later, that boy shows up at the hunt and is like, where'd you get that thing? That's the one you gave up on.
Yeah.
That's the one that Jesus knew all the time. His kernel just ain't popped yet.
Yeah.
You know, every kernel in a bag of popcorn pops at a different time. Same heat, same temperatures.
Yep.
All of a sudden you hear pop, 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 pop. Yep. One pop first, one pop last. You open the bag, can you tell which one it was?
Amen.
Nope. I just want to make sure I pop.
Yep. I don't want to get
go to Romans chapter 8. We're going to get into the deep part of this here in a minute. Stage has been set about picking up your cross, spiritual warfare. Romans chapter 8. I love Romans 8. Romans chapter 8, we're going to start at verse 5. I'm going to read some of this because it's so easy to understand. Romans 8, 5, it says, for they that are after the flesh, they mind the things of the flesh. That's all they live for. Those that are after the flesh, they just live for the flesh. But those that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit, you've been around those people that are spiritually minded. That's all their life is. Everything you do, oh, that's of the Spirit. That's of the Lord. It's amazing. Look at verse 6. For to be carnally minded, fleshly minded, is what? Death. You want to live fleshly? You want to battle Satan fleshly? You're ready to die. You want to live in the flesh? You want to indulge yourself in the flesh? It's death. It's going to cost you. For the carnally minded is death. But, I love these. To be spiritually minded is a two-on-one deal. It's a two-for-one deal. I love two-for-one deals. If you're in the flesh, you get death. If I'm in the Spirit, I get life. And an infomercial added piece.
Yes. Yeah.
God never fights fair. I didn't give you the spirit of fear. What did I give you?
Power. Love.
Three-on-one deal. That's a really good deal. That's not a BOGO deal. That's a three-for-one deal.
Yeah.
In this one, if you live by the flesh, you're going to reap death. But if you live in the Spirit, you're going to reap life and peace. I don't know about you, but I would like to have a lot more peace in my life.
Amen.
How do I get it? Quit living in the flesh. I wish my life was a little bit smoother. Well, good. Get out of the flesh. Get more of the Spirit, and you're going to see more peace. Oh, good. Why? Why? Because the carnal mind is enmity against God.
Yeah,
right. Folks, can we have church today? Can we actually have church and realize that your sin is separating you from God? Buddy, I've had my life packed full of sin. It's cost me. It's cost me. It's cost me things I was never willing to give.
It's not what I bargained for. I thought this was supposed to be just fun for a moment.
No, it's not. Now it's going to cost you for an eternity.
Sin will separate you from God. Lord, I just don't feel your presence like I once did.
Let me tell you, there's sin there.
Lord, I just don't feel that closeness. There's something separating you, and you've got to be honest. Get out of the flesh, get in the spirit, and let him work.
It might even be good religious acts.
It might even be the time that I have to spend doing godly things. That's separating you from God.
Well, how can that be? Because you're doing it in a fleshly mind and not in a spiritually mind. Man. Carnal minds are enmity of God, for it is not subject to the law of God. Neither indeed can it be.
So, this is a hard verse. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But I read my Bible today.
Don't matter.
But I went to church today. Don't matter. But I memorized verses.
Doesn't matter. If you're in the flesh, your fleshly works cannot please a spiritual God.
Amen. Can't happen. Cannot happen. Well, I memorized 25 verses so I can win a sucker.
That's great. We need to get our kids to learn the verses, but we need to back it with the spiritual reasons why. Listen, I won all kinds of things when I was a kid. Man, I remember one time I lived out in Illinois. My dad was at Bible school, and we had a big old church, and we were very, very poor. I mean, dirt poor. We lived out of the church's food pantry. That's how we ate. If the food pantry wasn't stocked, we went hungry. My dad didn't have a job. He was in Bible school, and they let us live in an apartment. While we were there, if you've ever been to Peoria, Illinois, we lived a half a block away from the Civic Center. Now, if you've ever been to a Civic Center, you know it's downtown city. If you know anything about Peoria, it's where all the drugs and gangs go out of Chicago. It is awful. I've told my wife story after story after story. She's like, this can't be true, until she went and seen it. She bought it. So we lived. They had a competition at church. They were giving away this great big, gigantic stocking filled with toys. I'm like, I could win that. Because I'm probably not going to get anything for Christmas.
Yeah.
So I'm going to win that. And I had to memorize 50 scripture verses and stand in front of the church and quote all the verses and every book of the Bible within a certain time period. And the first kid to do it won the prize. Thank you. Sometimes fleshly rewards lead to some spiritual stuff with kids. I'm not saying that we should not entice them to learn the Word of God, but we got to let them, as they grow older, say, this is why. This is why the weapon works.
Amen.
There's more to it. It's not just milk. There's some meat. There's some steak and potatoes in there.
Yeah.
Keep reading. But you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Listen, if you're here today and you're not saved, let me tell you what you're not. You are not a child of God. If you are here today and you are not saved, you, my friend, are a child of Satan. That's a fact. I love you. I want you on my team. I want you with Jesus Christ. But there are two teams. There is Team A, Jesus' team. Team B, Satan's team. There is no in between. If you do not have God in your life, and I didn't say the fleshly rituals of God, if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you've not accepted him and the blood that he shed on the cross for your sins, if you have not opened your mouth and accepted that and received that gift, you are not of God. Period. And if you're not of God, you're an enemy of God.
That's right.
That's what the Bible says.
Right.
Ben didn't say that. The Bible said that. But I praise God that while I was yet a sinner, an enemy, he loved me.
Yes,
he died for me.
Yep.
While I was his enemy, he gave all.
Yeah. Woo! Different message, different right on, buddy. Right on.
Verse 11. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, that same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead, I love that song.
He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken, make alive your mortal body by his Spirit that dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh. We're not debt to this flesh. We don't owe this flesh nothing. Amen. I don't owe Satan anything. Amen. He doesn't own me. I don't owe him nothing. I am in debt up to my ears to Jesus. For if we live after the flesh, you're going to die. For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if ye, through the Spirit, do mortify the deeds of the body, if you're God, you're going to live. Now, here comes five things. I want you to, if you take notes, this is five good things. I'm going to give you an old-fashioned message, but not 3 points. I'm going to give you five things. The next few verses gives you five things that when you pick up that cross, Lord, I'm picking up the cross. What do I get for it? Lord, I'm accepting you as my Savior. What do I get? Here's the five things. Number one thing that you get is security. Look at verse 14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they're the sons of God.
Amen.
That is a promise. That is total security. I am a child of God when I am in the Spirit. I am God's. He is mine. I am his.
Amen.
Period. Number one, security. Number two, oh, I love this one. Verse 15a. For if you've not received the spirit of bondage again, you didn't get that spirit of bondage again, but you've received the spirit of adoption. That's authority. That's authority.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, we kind of overlook the word adoption in America. Let me tell you what the word adoption meant to the readers at that time. I've got four boys. If I was back in the Bible day, under the law, I could remove one of my boys from my family. I could remove him. Corbin would be on the chopping block. Let's say that Corbin messes up royally. I, as his dad, can go, you are no longer a Hall. You're done. You are out of the will. You're out of the family name. You're out of everything. You have lost all rights. Here's the other law. But if I was to adopt, if I adopt, there's no way I can kick him out of the family. It's over. The law back then said, if I adopt a child, he has more claims and rights to my name than anybody else.
Amen.
He is no longer of the world. He is no longer the family that he once came from. He is my child. And no matter what he does, I can't remove him, even if I wanted to remove him.
Amen.
You are saved. You are adopted.
Amen.
Satan no longer has a claim on your life. Satan no longer has a right to your life. You are a child of the King, and not he can't even remove you.
Adoption.
I could kick out Caleb, but if I had adopted Corbin, I can't kick out Corbin because the law says he's already been through enough.
Yeah.
Think about this from a spiritual mind.
Yeah.
Spiritually, where it's not a fleshly message. If Caleb's my son and I've adopted Corbin, the law says I can kick him out. But Corbin's already been through enough.
Yeah.
There's nothing you can do to remove him.
Yeah,
praise the Lord. That's salvation.
Yeah, that is awesome.
There is nothing that can pull you from the grips of the Lord God himself. It says it doesn't matter what it is. Nothing can separate you from the love of Christ.
Yeah.
I couldn't imagine about not having security in my authority. I'm a child of the King. Look at part B. Whereby we cry, Abba, Father. You also have intimacy.
Yeah.
Ooh. God, I'm having a bad day.
Yeah.
God, they're after me again. Crawl up on my lap. Let me hold you.
Yeah.
Hey, Grandpa.
I kind of look at it as the grandpa, you know? You crawl up on grandpa's lap, you crawl up on grandma's lap, and what does she do? You just stole the cookies out of the cookie jar, and mom done tanned your hide, and you're crying, your butt is sore, it's got blisters, and what does grandma do? Oh, honey, you cut right on over here.
Yeah.
Let me love you. You got chocolate smeared all over your face, and you're saying, I didn't do it.
Yeah.
And mom's like, I just caught him. Abba Father, I can cry up and crawl up into the lap and he can love. I not only have security, I not only have authority because I now carry the same name, I now have intimacy. Man, I love what God does.
Yes.
Amen. That's why the Bible says a man that will lose his life actually gains life. It's the man that holds on to it that actually loses.
Yep.
Look at verse 16. There's more. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. You know what that is? That's assurance.
Amen.
That's assurance. The Holy Spirit convenes with my spirit back and forth with God that even in my worst of times, that's still our kid.
Yep,
right. Hey, Jesus, that's your brother.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah.
That's my brother. Jesus was very clear. He goes, I'm a friend that sticks closer than a brother.
Yeah.
God the head said that when I'm saved, I become a joint heir with Christ. That's a brother.
Yeah.
Man, I love the things that God has. Look at the last one. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God. Heirs of what? Listen, I'm an heir. I love my parents, but when they pass away, I'm not getting up. I'm going to do some bills. So I love it.
Yep.
But when you become an heir to a king,
that's right.
When you become an heir to the Lord of hosts, oh man, that's a different smile. That's different zeros.
Yeah.
There's a number before the zero. It says, and if the children, then heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we might be glorified together.
Amen.
And I love verse 18. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not even worthy to be compared with the glory that will be revealed in us.
Yes. Amen.
I love that. That makes me more excited than the airship, than the authority, than the security, than the intimacy. I know that the sufferings, and trust me, there's been sufferings. There's been a lot of sufferings. There are so many sufferings going on in our family right now. But I know for a fact they are this big compared to the glory when it's revealed. Man, pick up the cross, Peter. Where do you want your memories? You going to let your memories be stronger than your vision? Hey, Peter, pick up the cross. Because if you're willing to pick up your cross, remember, you're also declaring that you're ready to fight. You're ready to battle. It's amazing what God has for us when we read his word. I love the fact Jesus himself went through it. What's it say in Hebrew? It says that he endured the cross. What made it so that he can endure it? The vision of you in heaven with him. It says he fixed his eyes on what was to come, and so he endured the cross. That pain, that affliction of picking up the cross was made worthy in his vision, not the memories, but in the vision, it makes it worth going through the hell that we go through on earth. It is. That's what it is. It's hell on earth when we're in battle. It's Satan battling. He brings it to our front door. Guess what, Satan? I got authority. Satan, guess what? I was adopted. You're no longer my father.
Absolutely. That's a fact.
You're not my father anymore. You can't pull me back there and use that belt on me anymore. I got a father that'll fight my battles for me.
Yeah.
Amazing what happens when we start reading this word and we understand it. Peter, time to go to work. Christians, how many of us, though, man, we love them. That sounds good, brother. You're going to walk out of here, you're going to start thinking. You're going to start listening to that voice in your head that says,
It's a lie. Jesus identified it very clear. Not only is he a liar, he's the chief of all liars. No truth is found in him. When you can identify the fact that that's Satan's voice, immediately he lost all credibility. He is a liar. He's a loser. He's a liar. And there's no truth found in him. He's never won a battle on the spiritual realm. Not one. Michael is raining out of heaven. The angels, I mean, he's a defeated foe.
Yep.
He's got no bite on you anymore. Well, why? Because you're adopted.
Yeah.
You're adopted. He lost all claims. You're the child of the king.
Right.
You're a joint heir with Jesus.
Right.
And so these sufferings that you're going through, they don't even compare to the glory that you're going to see.
Amen.
Oh, my goodness. I love it. I want to go to 2 Corinthians. We go to end this. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. A couple verses here that I want to sink into our minds. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we don't war after the flesh.
Right.
For the weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, they're not fleshly, they're mighty, and they're through God to the pulling down of strongholds.
Amen.
Casting down imaginations. Now, I stop right there. I want you to get what this imagination is. You got to read prior to understand the word imagination. What is an imagination? Oh, that kid's got a great imagination. When do we say that? After he's done what or she's done what? Made up something.
Yeah. Yeah.
A good imagination is the person that can turn this book into an airplane and fly it for 2 hours and have fun. That's a good imagination. It's false interpretation of the truth. Now let's read it again and add in false interpretation of the truth.
Yeah.
Casting down false information or interpretation of the truth. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ.
Yeah.
You want to win? You got to start remembering what God said.
Amen.
Amen. When things come against this word, get behind me, Satan. You're a defense to me.
Amen.
Well, that I can't say that to somebody. That's offensive. Jesus Christ said to somebody.
Yeah.
Can we not start calling things for what they are?
Yeah.
If it's contrary to this word of God. Now listen, there's going to be sins in your life that are contrary to this word of God. Guess what? Get them fixed.
Amen.
Get them changed.
Yeah.
This word is supposed to be offensive. We live in a world where everything's got to be bubble wrap, sugar coated, and rainbow colored.
Yeah.
Why? Because no one wants to change anything. This word is offensive. If it's not offensive, it'll never change you. Amen. It should be abrasive. It should be like lye soap on your skin.
Yeah.
It'll scrub away everything except the bone. That's where we need cleansed to. So we can pick up our cross, not so we can be condemned and stomped on. The Bible doesn't clean you up to cast you out. It cleans you up to bring you in.
Amen.
Cast down every false imagination. Cast out all that false garbage. Get behind me, Satan. Because we got work to do. We got work to do. Now, I'm going to tell you, I don't know what everybody's stance is with the Lord. I would be naive and stupid to think every single person would say. It'd be crazy to think every time you preach somewhere, everybody would say. Man, that'd be great, but the Bible says broad is the way to destruction and narrow is the way to life. I'm going to give you a little story here, a little interpretation I like to use sometimes. One thing about the military. Tim and I joined the military. Tim goes in, he joins the military, he signs up, he walks out to the truck, gets in the truck, he is now a proud, signed up, enlisted member of the U.S. military. I jump in the side of the truck with him. Let's go, brother. Me and him take off. We go to boot camp together. We go through training together. Next thing you know, we're competing for, you know, some really good accolades together. And all of a sudden, we get our call, and we go to battle. And me and Tim are in a foxhole together. And I got his back, and he's got my back. And man, there are bombs going off and there are lights going off. And man, we did a lot of good together. We get back on U.S. soil and people are like, oh man, this was great. You guys were awesome. You did amazing work for the military.
That's right. We did. Yes, we did. And all of a sudden we walk up to our retirement day.
Time to collect our benefits.
All of a sudden, Jeremy's sitting there and Jeremy goes, well, hey, Tim, dude, you enlisted. Look at all the things you did. Here's all the honors and the medals. And dude, you did a wonderful job. Look what all you did. Here's your pension. Great is your reward. Well done, fellow soldier. And I'm like, I was there the whole time with him. He's like, yeah, but Ben, I didn't see it. You just hopped in the truck. You didn't come in here and sign the enlist form.
Well, yeah, but I was with him the whole time. Look what I did. I fought with him. I killed people with him. I defended our country with him. Look, I was there the whole time beside him. I did everything that he did.
He did it less.
So what do I get?
Apart from me. You were never a part of the military the whole time.
I wasted my whole time to...
You didn't enlist. Didn't sign the sheet. There's going to come a day, folks, when the God opens up the Bible or opens up the Lamb's Book of Life.
Right.
I casted out demons in your name. I preached in your name. I fed the hungry and the poor in your name. I helped all these people. I did the same things that Tim did. Yeah, well, guess what? Tim signed the sheet. Brother, your name is not written down in the Lamb's Book of Life.
But look what I did.
Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Guys, that's scripture. Are we going to attack this world fleshly and do all the works? Or are we going to attack it spiritually and let God be our guide the whole way?
Amen.
Is your vision stronger than your memories? So many of us never pick up our cross because our memories are too strong and they overtake our vision. We got a song. It'll be a good time. I know I want to open up these altars. Time to pray. Time to seek God's face. It might be you that says, man, I've been doing a lot of good work for this military, but you know what? Brother Ben, I don't think I really signed the sheet. Let's sign the sheet. It doesn't matter if you sign the sheet in the first inning, on the seventh inning stretch, or in the ninth inning with two outs, bases loaded, and we're almost done. The Bible says the reward is the same.
Yes, it is.
He specifically said it. The guy hired in the morning, the guy noon, and the guy hired with 20 minutes left got the same paycheck.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter when you sign the sheet, just sign the sheet.
Yeah, man.
Maybe that's you today. Maybe it's you sitting here thinking, well, I haven't picked up my cross, because every time I've been down to pick up that cross, it's not the blood rushing to my head, it's the memories flooding my brain. And I just can't pick it up because I don't feel that I'm worthy enough. Well, guess what? You're right.
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, I do thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for this group of people, Lord. Lord, it reminds me of Gideon's army today. Lord, they're small, but they're mighty. Lord, they've been attentive. Lord, they've listened, God, and they've allowed themselves to be filled like a sponge, but God, it's time now to pour out. Lord, if there is a soul here today that is not saved, God, I pray that today is the day of their salvation. Lord, let them come and list. Let them reap the benefits of being in the military of Christ. Lord, for those that are struggling with picking up that cross, God, Lord, I just pray that we, as a church, as a family, Lord, that we help them remove what's there, not taunt them and tease them for not doing more work. Lord, you don't want more work. You want more surrender.
Amen.
More surrender. God, be with us today. Lord, be with those that have that cross raised up high. Lord, they're taking fire. Lord, but your word says that you are our buckler and you are our shield. You're our defender. You're our high tower. And you are ever ready in the presence of danger. God, I thank you and I praise you for this morning, God. Be with us as we open up these altars. Lord, let us now take our time to respond to your word. And we'll praise you for it. In your holy and precious name, I pray.
Amen.
Amen.